Okay, welcome. Thank you for joining us in conservation biology section. So Hawaiian Islands are known as a place of incredible diversity due to their isolation from continental systems. And so there are well-known radiations such as the honey creepers, bird group, and some that are perhaps well-known in some evolutionary circles, but less known more broadly, such as the Hawaiian tree snails. So the Hawaiian tree snails are an incredible radiation. This is just diversity within one genus. You can see the incredible morphological diversity as well as color variation within this genus. And so today we're going to be focusing on a specific species that occurs in the Waianae mountain range on Oahu, Acatinella muscelina. So this occurs down a 25-kilometer north to south range. Over an environmental gradient that occurs from 1,100 millimeters of precipitation of rain per year all the way up to 1,900 millimeters of rain per year. So Hawaiian tree snails as a group are interesting in that they take up to 4 to 6 years to reach maturity. They have very long lifespans, up to 20 years long, and they have very low fecundity of 5 to 10 offspring per year in live birth. And they're hermaphroditic, and some species self-fertilize, which also makes them interesting. Finally, they have very minimal movement and high site fidelity. So if they disappear from a place, they're unlikely to recolonize it again, unless there are high wind events, which tend to move them up to 1,000 years. So at most, you know, very, very minimal movement. They've been devastated by introduced species to the islands, such as rats, Eulandina rosea, which is a predatory snail that specializes on mollusks, as well as Jackson's chameleon. So between those three predators, some generalists, some very specific ones, they've been decimating those populations. So there are predator-free enclosures that are built. It costs over $100,000 a piece, so you need to choose where you put them very carefully. And it's thought that within about 60 years' time, the only snails that will be remaining will be within these predator-free enclosures. So that's a concern due to climate change. So if you look at their range today, which is about 25 kilometers north to south, compared to suitable habitat in the future, which is in the green, it will be only maybe constricted to about a 5 kilometer range north to south in the future. So a very restricted range in the future. Most of the existing exposures today will be outside suitable habitat in 60 years' time. So they're important today for preserving diversity, but we need to consider putting an additional one on the top of Mount Kala and very carefully considering which snails are put within that enclosure to maximize diversity and the ability to adapt to a changing climate. This becomes important because of genetic structuring within this species. So in 2002, using a single marker study of CO1, six evolutionary significant units were identified. And I'll be referring to ESUs A, B, C, D, E, and F throughout this talk, and you can see the structure there. These are geographically structured, so if you look over the range and compare that to what will be suitable habitat in the future, you might note that a lot of the diversity will be lost over time or will be outside the suitable range. And those are populations that are within the driest and hottest habitats today, so they're the ones most likely to contain allelic variants that'll help with adaptation in the future. So one potential thing is to try to coax or introduce alleles into those areas that are currently cooler and wetter. And hopefully as climate change occurs, because it's a gradual process, those allelic variants that are less suitable will disappear, and those that are suitable will remain. So our study objectives were to identify gene regions associated with taxonomic structure, as well as potentially with environmental adaptation. And this has conservation implications, both for which populations should be combined to maximize the ability to adapt to a hotter, drier climate, as well as evolutionary implications. So this, back in the 1800s, there was a great debate between a guy by the name of Gulick, who is less famous than his Darwin counterpart, but Gulick argued for genetic drift as an evolutionary process as opposed to selection. And Hawaiian tree snails were actually one of the examples that he looked at and said, hey, this is a fantastic example where we've got comparable environments, but we see different species, high variation, just because of geographic distance and genetic drift. So we're revisiting this story. We use non-lethal tissue sampling, because these are endangered species, over the range, and included populations from all of the different ESUs, and then individually extracted the DNA, quantified each sample, pooled by equal amounts of DNA. So this is a way of, with a non-model organism, getting around the issue of cost, and digesting with GATC restriction enzymes and side-selecting fragments. And we use the Illumina-MiC platform, again, because it's a non-model organism. The closest genome is quite a distance away. And so this way we have long enough sequences that we can actually identify what we're looking at. And then did the cleanup in bioinformatics. So our data we generated for 22 populations of Accidental Masculina, from pooled 1550 samples, individuals per population. And then we also additionally looked at 37 populations representative of 26 additional species, representing also from 6 genera and 3 subfamilies. So you get that broader look. About 100 gigabytes of DNA, 3 to 6 million reads per pooled population sample. So we've identified about 100,000 SNPs that were informative. Both nuclear, about 99.9% are nuclear, and mitochondrial, which are about 0.01%. That 0.01% of the reads was enough for us to identify 5 mitochondrial genomes for 5 species. So we're able to compare those across the different species, and then partial for the remaining, that should be 54 populations. And we published those mitochondrial genomes. So when you compare mitochondrial genomes across this single species, you find similar genetic structure to what was found using the single mitochondrial marker in the past, which shouldn't be that surprising. What is interesting is it divides into these 2 very clear groups, with ESUs A, B, and C in this group, and E, D, E, and F in this group. When we zoom out to compare that across the different subfamilies, or across the subfamily, which gives us a broader view, one of the things that you notice, so in black, I've color-coded the genus Acutinella, green is the genus Pertilina, and then the blue is the genus Pertusella. And when we look across this, we see that things that, first of all, it's polyphyletic. This is not a great, we need some taxonomic revision here, which is also suggested using single marker studies, but is now supported looking across mitochondrial genomes. And then the other thing that you see is that potentially, and also given morphological support, these should probably be divided into 2 species. Since when we look at things that are currently grouped as 2 separate genera, the level of difference that we see for these is definitely comparable to the level of difference we're seeing within a single species here. When we then went and looked, instead of just looking at mitochondrial genomes, but also looked across 92,000 SNPs across the genome, we still see this very clear divide, looking at this PCA analysis, where things generally divide into ESUs ABC and DEF. Now, we asked the question, okay, what is driving these differences? Because when you look at the geographic distribution, that divide comes right along here. So the blue, green, and purple is in that group ABC. The orange, yellow, and white are in the DEF group. And so it's, we weren't sure, other than kind of this ridge line, there isn't any clear environmental difference between these 2 groups. There is a mountain here, but these are all ridge lines coming down the mountain. So there wasn't an obvious geographic reason for this. I sat down with a geologist who is an expert in this particular mountain range. There is a fault line that occurs right there, but the timing doesn't seem to be exactly right for the division between these 2 groups, as far as molecular clock type of calculations that have been done and the geological time clock. So we have a little bit more work to do there to see what that might be. We've also done FST outlier analysis, and I'm working with a lot of coral biologists. And when they see this level of fixed differences between populations, they get kind of excited. And so looking across the top here at the FST outliers, and then blasting those regions to say what genes are they associated with, what we find is that about 50% of the SNPs that are diagnostic between these two groups are transposable elements and viral genes that have been associated with aplysia, which is within the molluscan family or molluscan group. And so there's been a lot of work showing that transposable elements can be involved in evolution. And so this is the launch, the beginning of a lot of interesting work. We have a lot of directions that we can go with this. The whole mitochondrial genomes have similar relationships as CO1 alone. Using a total information approach, again, there's general agreement between mitochondrial and nuclear information as far as the taxonomic groupings. But then when you start looking at what actually the SNPs that are associated with separating out these groups, about 50% of loci are blasting to viral or transposable elements. So we're excited to dig down further into this. Differences between the two major groups of Bacterial and Mesalina, along with the morphological differences, suggest that these may warrant species status. The next steps include looking deeper at the role of the viral and transposable elements, as well as the SNPs that are associated with climatic gradients. So one thing that makes this system fantastic, even just within this particular species, is that, so I've color-coded this so you can see the precipitation gradient. So within this top group, you have the range from very dry, about 1,100 millimeters of rain per year, up to very wet, with 1,900 millimeters of rain per year. And also in the second group down here, you have that same range from 1,100 millimeters of rain per year up to about 1,900 millimeters of rain per year. So we have a great environmental gradient to look across and to also dig down into environmentally associated SNPs. This, I should mention, also occurs across, this subfamily occurs across six islands. So you've got repeated colonization events across very similar environmental gradients. So a fantastic system, and we're excited to continue working within it. So with that, I'll take any questions. Yes?
Do you have evidence that the transposable elements are moving a lot?
We haven't gotten that far, but I'm excited to potentially take a look at that. So we haven't dug down that far yet, but those are definitely part of our next questions that we'll be asking. Yeah. Any other questions? Yes.
Are there cultural or ecological services arguments for the maintenance of these trees wells?
That's a question I get asked all the time. Why snails? This has got to be one of the only invertebrate groups globally that is held in really high cultural esteem. So we actually have a student that did cultural studies looking at Hawaiian newspapers that were published, the old what are called mo'olelo or stories, Hawaiian stories, and they were held in extremely high esteem by Hawaiians, associated with the power of voice. And when in certain stories, when they reached a certain point, different birds would sing. When it got to the best part of the story, the tree snails would sing. So yeah, there's definitely cultural significance. They graze on fungal microbial communities on the leaf surface, so they do provide important ecological services in both reducing fungal biomass and actually increasing diversity, species diversity of fungi on the leaf surface.